Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. So my name is Benoît Commerson. So I'm a researcher based at INS de Lyon in France. So I'm here to present you the chapter number 9, entitled A Revised Paradigm of the Role of Magnetic Fields for Disk Formation and Outflow Driving Towards an Understanding of the First Stage of Planet Formation. So I'm here on behalf of the authors of this chapter, so led by Yuzuke Tsukamoto. Then co-authors are Anel Mori, Felipe Alves, Erin Cox, Nami Sakai, Tom Ray, Bozao, Masahiro Mashida, and myself. So I would like especially to thank Anel Mori for helping me to prepare the observational part of this talk and for her precious time she spent in trying to teach me how observations were done. Okay, so here are the outline of the talk. So first I will introduce a bit the context of this chapter, then I will go to observation, then to simulations, and then I will finish by giving you some perspectives. Okay, so to begin with, I will begin with a fact. So as you have seen this morning, magnetic fields are there. They are important in star formation, and they cannot be ignored. Okay, so now we have to see how the magnetic field evolves down to the protostellar core scale, so the stellar core when it is formed. Before continuing, I would like to remind you two of the main problems we have in star formation when we consider protostellar collapse. The first one is about angular momentum conservation. Okay, if one assumes that the core is initially rotating and that angular momentum is conserved, then we see that the ratio between the rotational and the gravitational energy increases as the radius decreases, which means at some point the collapse will stop and a disk should form. Also, if you look at this diagram, which look at the specific angular momentum as a function of the radius for different objects, you see that if we want to go from the molecular cloud scale down to the solar system and the sun, we have to lose 10 orders of magnitude in angular momentum, which means that a collapsing core must get rid of most of its angular momentum during the collapse phase. Another problem is about magnetic field. So if one assumes that the magnetic field and the gas are perfectly coupled, then we look at the evolution between the magnetic energy and the gravitational energy, we find that this ratio is constant. It only depends on the initial mass to flux ratio, which means that if magnetic field is important at the beginning, at core scale, then it will remain important during protostellar collapse. And if we take typical numbers of magnetic field amplitude in the ISM and compute the resulting magnetic field assuming a magnetic flux conservation, we end up with a magnetic field of 10 to the 10 Gauss, which is not what is observed in stars. So in star magnetic fields are the order of kilogauss. So as angular momentum, we must get rid of magnetic flux, which should be transported away during the gravitational collapse. Okay. So now let's go to the review of the work that has been done during the past 10 years, so about observation. So I remind you, I'm doing numerical simulations, so we'll try to do my best to do this review on observations. Okay. So how do we measure magnetic field first? So we could measure it using synchrotron emission, but for embedded protostar, we don't have energetic electrons, so there is no detection. So we have to go to other techniques. So the first one is to use the dichroic extinction, where you look at how the unpolarized light from background stars gets polarized by the dust when they go through star-forming cores. So here is an example in the B335 protostar. So this mechanism works well, but when there is a protostellar disk that is forming in the collapsing protostar, then there is an anisotropic radiation field, and then it's become ambiguous to derive the magnetic field topology from these techniques. Then we could use the Zeeman effect, but as density increases, the line become optically thick, okay, and it's hard to detect the Zeeman effect for the moment. Another way, as we have seen this morning, is to use the linear polarization of the dust emission if one assumes that there is a mechanism to align the grain with the magnetic field. So for instance, the radiative alignment torque theory. Then, so this indicates the plane of the sky magnetic field. Then we can use the Davis-Chandrasekhar-Fermi method in order to get the amplitude of the magnetic field. But this method assumes energy equipartition. And in the collapsing core, gravity dominates. So this assumption should also break. A last way to observe magnetic field is to use, the Goldreich-Killafis effect, which can give us some information using spectral light polarization. Today, the most widely used technique for collapsing protostar is the linear polarization of the dust emission. And as you have understood, all the other techniques suffer from the fact that the protostellar core is collapsing and we are in embedded protostar with a massive envelope. So there have been some observations of magnetic field at core scales, as we have seen this morning, so I won't spend a lot of time on it. So just to say that for low mass cores, what we see is that when magnetic field is, dust polarization is detected, the magnetic field is well ordered and exhibits this famous hourglass shape, which is indicative of magnetically regulated collapse. It's maybe not the case for more massive protostars, but here more statistics is needed. So then from this map, one can apply the Davis-Chandrasekhar Fermi method to get the strength of the magnetic field. So here in Liu et al. 2022, they get an amplitude of the magnetic field of the order of milligauss in collapsing core. Going down the scale, there have been two evidence of magnetic field at the disk scale. So here are two examples. So in the famous HH2 12 protostar, where they indicate a mix between toroidal and polyhedral magnetic field line. Okay, so here it becomes ambiguous because maybe self-scattering can also give some polarization. Okay, but if this polyhedral field is confirmed, for instance using dust polarization, then this means that the field is polyhedral in the disk, and it is required in order to launch MHD disk wind, as we will see later this week in a talk by Sylvie Cabri. So, very hard to measure directly magnetic field in protostar, so we have to find some other way to test models and test different theories. So, the first thing to look at is to look at the disk radius. So if magnetic field is there, magnetic breaking should break the cloud and make small disk. So here is a compilation of disk radii for class 0 and class 1 protostar from the submillimeter emission of the dust continuum. And what we found is that the class 0 disks are about 60 AU, while the class 1 disks are 80 AU. So in both cases, disks are compact, okay, which might be indicative of magnetic breaking. What we also see is that there might be a trend of increasing disk radius with the age. So still matter of debate. One can also get the disk mask, so I won't go deep into this. So assuming that the dust emission is optically thin, one can get the disk mass, but this suffers from a lot of uncertainty since the density are quite high. And there seems to be a slight trend of decreasing mass with the age. So young disk seems to be more massive. Another way to test the disk size is to have access to the kinematics in collapsing cloud. So here are three examples where Keplerian motion have been observed at this scale. So in this work by Azo et al., you see here the rotation velocity as a function of the radius, and this rotation velocity exhibits two behaviors. So at low radius, there is this 0.5 minus 0.5 scaling relation, which is indicative of a Keplerian rotation, and then a steeper slope, which is indicative of a collapsing envelope. So from that, we can get the disk radius, which is about 70 AU, so consistent, again, with the compact size. Another example is this work by Nami Sakai, where they observe accretion shock at the centrifugal barrier. Okay, so we can do a lot about chemistry here, so I won't go into that, but it's just to show that, again, it is consistent with the compact size in young protostars. Thanks to HALMA, we can also now have more detailed rotation, angular momentum as a function of the radius for given objects. Okay? And what observers have found is that there is two trends. So first, at large radius, there is this steep slope. So as we have seen this morning, this is compatible with a turbulent motion at molecular cloud scale. And then below 1000 AU, you see that there is a break, and the slope becomes shallower, so the angular momentum still decreases in the collapsing protostar, which means that angular momentum is removed. So maybe, again, an indication of magnetic breaking. Also, what you see is that when collapse starts here at about 1000 AU, we have already lose almost two orders of magnitude in the angular momentum. So maybe the angular momentum problem is less as severe as previously thought when we had access only to the larger scale. Okay. A great achievement also on the observation side has been to observe the magnetic field evidence in outflows. So using the Godrej-Kilafis effect, Ching et al. And Carrasco-Gonzalez et al. Have observed evidence of poloidal magnetic field in the outflow. Okay. So here I should say that the GK effect has a 90 degree uncertainty, so maybe the field is poloidal, so this observation should be confirmed, for instance, using the dust polarization measurement. But if it is the case, again, it goes into the favor of magnetically driven outflows and jets. Another important achievement has been to observe rotation in very young protostars, so class zero protostars. So here are two examples. So the Orion Source 1, so it's a massive YSO by Hirota et al., where they observed a velocity gradient perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the outflow, so indication of rotation in the outflow. And on HH212, different observations. So in particular, this observation by Tabon et al., where they show evidence of a low velocity wide opening angle outflow, so here traced by the CS emission. Then well-collimated jet inside the outflow, traced by the SIO. And finally, evidence of rotation from the disk, here traced by the C17O. And when they go deeper inside the protostar, they show that the outflow is also rotating in the same direction than the disk, which is again consistent with MHD disk winds. Lee et al. Have further confirmed this by going to even smaller scale and probing rotation in the outflow using SO emission. So they show that the outflow can be driven at scale smaller than 20 AU. It has been also further confirmed in this young class 1 TMC1 protostar. So this is consistent, again, with magnetically driven outflows. I would like to finish the observation part now by mentioning this work on the B335 protostar, which is a kind of a prototype protostar. So a lot of work has been done during the past 10 years on this particular protostar. So first, the work by Yen et al. Has shown that there is no large Keplerian disk in this protostar, and that there is no evidence of decoupling between the neutrals and the ions at in the envelope, which means that the gas and the magnetic field are well coupled, so there is a strong magnetic breaking, so no large disk is formed. It has been further confirmed by Cabedo et al. Recently, who infer a high ionization degree, so in the interior of the collapsing core, which is again suggestive of a strong coupling between magnetic field and the gas. So they explain maybe this high ionization degree by the central protostar, so maybe by cosmic ray acceleration at accretion shocks or in outflows and jets. And finally, this dust polarization map, so the magnetic field inferred from the dust polarization map by Mori et al. 2018, where they try to reproduce this polarization pattern using numerical models. And what they found is that only the magnetized model can reproduce this pattern with a strong magnetic field. Okay. So in at least one protostar, there is evidence that only the magnetized models can work. So I think in the future, clearly, we should do more things like for this protostar, so focus on a single object, pay the price, but try to get as much as we can information. So the takeaway message from this first part is that we now have evidence of a strong and organized magnetic field down to the disk scale. We have seen that the disks are compact in size, and there is evidence of angular momentum evolution, so possibly magnetic breaking. And we have seen that we have the first evidence of rotation and toroidal magnetic field in outflow, which is again compatible with MHD this wind. Okay, so now let's go to the simulation side and see what are the advances in the past 10 years. So before I begin, I would like to remind you this star formation evolutionary sequence as derived by Philippe André 2002. So here we will focus on the transition between the pre-stellar phase and the protostellar phase, so the class zero stage, where the mass of the central object is still less than the mass of the envelope. So this is the first step is the protostellar collapse. And the protostellar collapse can be divided into four steps. So this has been established in the seminal work by Larson in 69, and this is still valid today, at least for low-mass protostars. So let me describe this different step. So you see here the evolution of the temperature as a function of the density in a collapsing core. Okay? So you see, we start here at the bottom left, so at low density and low temperature, and the core, the dense core, which is gravitationally unstable, can collapse under its own gravity because the dust can radiate freely the compressional energy. Okay? So we have an isothermal collapse until density of the order of 10 to the minus 13 gram per cc are reached, where the dust becomes optically thick to its own radiation. So the gas, which is coupled to the dust thermally, begins to heat adiabatically. So this stops the collapse, and the first hydrostatic object is formed, and it is called the first Larson core. The first Larson core has a size of about 10 AU, 1 to 10 AU. So the first Larson core will accrete material, so its central temperature will increase up to temperature of about 2000 K, where H2 dissociation will start, and H2 dissociation is an endothermal reaction, so it will take the gravitational energy to break the H2 molecule, and we will recover a quasi-isothermal behavior, which will enable a second collapse to proceed until stellar densities are reached here at the center. So in the first part, in the next part of the talk, I will focus on the first Larson core and first collapse scales, and then we will go down to the second collapse and second Larson core scales. Before I continue, I would like to be back in 2013 in Heidelberg with the conclusion of the chapter led by Zi Yun Li, where they had difficulty in forming disk. So first with idle MHD because of the strong accumulation of the magnetic flux, and also in 2D with non-idle MHD. So this was so the first problem was about magnetic flux accumulation at the center of the core, and the second problem was due to magnetic breaking. So I illustrate this here in this movie where you see the evolution of the density view from the top, view from the edge, in the collapsing one solar mass dense core. And you see that, well, an outflow is produced at the first Larson core scale. You see that a disk-like structure is formed here, but it's not a disk, it's a pseudo-disk. It is not supported by rotation, so it is infalling. And there is almost no rotation motion here in the center, so no disk is formed. So this is due to magnetic breaking, so because of the strong magnetic tension, the angular momentum is removed from the inner part and transported in the envelope along the magnetic field line. So this was called the magnetic breaking catastrophe, because disks were not forming anymore, and we observed this. So they should form at some point. I should mention, however, that, well, this magnetic breaking catastrophe solves quite nicely the angular momentum problem, because there is no more angular momentum left. Okay? So in the past 10 years, a lot of work has been done in order to bring back the disk in a numerical model. So the first possibility that has been suggested, also by the time of PP6, was a late formation, when there is no more envelope to accept the angular momentum from the inner part, so the angular momentum will stay in the center and the disk is growing. The second effect is about misalignment, so observations show that there is no preferred direction between the rotation axis and the magnetic field. Okay, and analytical and numerical work show that if there is a misalignment, this reduces the efficiency of the magnetic breaking during the main accretion phase. Okay, so this could form. Another mechanism that has been suggested is a turbulent reconnection. Okay, so this works quite well in when motions are supersonic, but for low-mass protostars, okay, motions are transonic or subsonic, so it's not very effective. So even if all these scenarios seem to work, the most promising and the most robust is when non-ideal MHD is included in model. So what is non-ideal MHD? So you have here the induction equation as commonly used today in numerical work in the star formation community. So you have in black here the ideal part where u is the velocity of the neutral. So in order to get the induction, we need the velocity of the charges. So we need to correct for this. And then three effects appear. So the first one is the ohmic diffusion, which is the diffusion of electrons onto neutral. Then we have the ambipolar diffusion, which is the diffusion of ions onto neutral. And finally, the Hall effect, which is the drift between the positively and negatively charged species. So you see that the Hall effect and the ambipolar diffusion can be written as a V cross B term, okay, which means that they will advect the magnetic field line at a different speed than the neutral speed. Also, the ohmic diffusion will provide some reconnection and magnetic flux diffusion. So now the game is to know how efficient are these mechanisms. So we need to know this eta coefficient, the resistivity. And for that, we need gas grain chemistry, and we need information on the dust grain population. So this has been also the subject of a lot of work in the past 10 years. So here I illustrate this with two work, Wurster and Marchand et al. 2016. You see here the evolution of the resistivity as a function of the density in collapsing core. So the temperature evolves with the density, as we just have seen. So what you see is that, well, in different density regions, different MHD process dominates. So first ambipolar diffusion, then the Hall effect, and finally the ohmic diffusion, which means that if we want to describe accurately non-ideal MHD in collapsing core, we need to account for this three effect. And because even more important, when we look at the characteristic times of non-ideal MHD processes and compare it with the freefall time. You see here the characteristic time as a function of the density, so derived from the resistivity I've just shown before, and the freefall time here. And you see that for a substantial range in density, here, the non-ideal MHD timescale is much shorter than the freefall timescale, which means that non-ideal MHD will regulate the dynamics in this density range. Okay. So if non-ideal MHD is included in a collapse model, so in similar model than the one I just have shown where there was this magnetic breaking catastrophe, what is happening? So here is the evolution of the magnetic field as a function of the density in the collapsing one solar mass dense core. In the ideal MHD here in red, where the magnetic field is amplified with the density because the magnetic flux is frozen, so magnetic field gets amplified. But with non-ideal MHD, so in that case it is ambipolar diffusion only, you see that there is a plateau at about 0.1 Gauss, and there is no further amplification of the magnetic field in the central part of the collapsing core. Okay? This is because ambipolar diffusion dominates and prevents any further accumulation of the magnetic field. So the magnetic field gets weaker, also it gets rearranged, so it is essentially poloidal, vertical. So this weakens the magnetic breaking, and then disk can form, so disks are back. If we look at the properties of this disk, so here are two examples, so the same calculation here by Masson et al, and here by Tsukamoto et al, accounting for ohmic diffusion and ambipolar diffusion. And what you see here, the color coding is the plasma beta. So plasma beta is the ratio between the thermal pressure and the magnetic pressure. So for plasma beta larger than one, it is dominated by thermal pressure. And you see that the disk region, when non-ideal MHD is included, correspond to regions where beta is larger than one, which means that the disks that are forming with non-ideal MHD are hydrodisks, completely different to the ones that are forming in ideal MHD, which are dominated by the magnetic pressure. We also see that these disks are relatively compact, between 10 and 50 AU, compatible with observation. And the orientation of the magnetic field is initially vertical. So we are now to the point where we can provide initial conditions for our colleagues who do a protoplanetary disk study, so we can give plasma beta and magnetic field orientations. So this result has been further confirmed in a lot of work. So for instance, when initial turbulence was included, so here's transonic initial turbulence, again the plateau at 0.1 Gauss. Changing the non-ideal effect, so here with the Hall effect by Tsukamoto et al, again a plateau at 0.1 Gauss. If we increase the mass in the turbulent massive core, 100 solar mass, Mignon-Riis et al. Have shown that again we have the same behavior, this plateau around 0.1 Gauss. And finally, in this work by myself, the plasma beta, even around massive star, so in the disk around massive star, exhibit disks where which are dominated by the thermal pressure. So clearly here there is a convergence, and this convergence was not achieved when we were using only ideal MHD, okay, because of resolution limit, because of instabilities that we are developing. So today, if you take each of these non-ideal effect independently, ohmic diffusion, ambipolar diffusion, all effect, disks are forming. So disks are back, they share the same property, they are compact, and they are dominated by the thermal pressure. And even when the free effects are included, like in this work by Wurster et al., the disks have the same properties. So the second takeaway message here is that, disk formation is regulated by non-ideal MHD processes. Magnetic regulation works for both low and high mass star formation. We have no prediction of the magnetic field at the disk scale that can be now probed with observation. And the disk radii, which we report, are compatible with the one that are observed at class zero stages. Okay, so now let's go deeper to the second collapse and second core formation. So let's see what is the sub-AU evolution of the magnetic field. So what you see here is the evolution of the magnetic field as a function of the density. Again, ideal MHD in red. So again, magnetic field is amplified all the way down to the protostar up to values of 10 to the 6 Gauss, a very strong field in the forming protostar. And when non-ideal MHD is included, you see that, well, we have first amplification, then the plateau at 0.1 Gauss, and then at high density, an increase of the magnetic field. So this is because at high density, temperature gets higher, and the magnetic field, so the ionization increase, and magnetic field coupled back to the gas. Okay? So the magnetic field gets amplified, but we start from a lower magnetization. So we end up with a magnetic field in the protostar, which are of the order of a kilogauss as observed. So what you see here is that, well, thanks to non-ideal MHD processes, the magnetic flux has been reduced by three orders of magnitude, and this solves the magnetic flux problem. So we end up with a realistic magnetization in protostars. And on top of that, now we can put the magnetic field evolution on top of the thermal evolution of the collapsing gas. So we have three different regimes. So first, during the first collapse, so in the envelope, the magnetic field is strong and coupled to the gas. So it provides an efficient magnetic braking. Then at density corresponding to the first Larsen core, the field decouples. The magnetic field decouples from the gas motion, and then it couples back, okay, when ionization is high enough, but in a weak field case. So which means that we are back to ideal MHD, but in a weak field case where it's essentially hydro motion. Okay. If we look at the topology of the magnetic field line here, so in ideal MHD, you see that we have essentially poloidal magnetic field line, so very strong magnetic braking, no rotation, no disk is forming. But with non-ideal MHD, you see that the disk is forming, and as the disk is weak, so the disk gets, a disk is forming, so first, and then by differential rotation, there is a generation of a toroidal field. Okay. So this toroidal field, as time goes on, will build up, okay, up to the point where it will launch a magnetic tower. And if we wait long enough, Machida and Bazou, 2019, managed to integrate over 2,000 years after the protostar formation, and they show the following feature for the outflow and jets. So you see the outflow cavity here launched at the first core radius, and then inside a well-collimated jet driven at the protostellar core scale. And I cannot resist to compare this to the observation by Tabon et al. And you see that clearly we have a very good comparison between models and simulation there. Also, rotation motion have been observed in outflows, and again, compatible, you see here the rotation, compatible with what is observed. So second takeaway message is that, well, non-ideal MHD can solve the magnetic flux problem. We now have a global picture of outflow and jet driving throughout the scale and at different MHD regime. So we see that we have evidence that the magnetic field is responsible for these jets and outflows. So in the last couple minutes that I have left, I will finish by giving you some perspective to where the field will go in the next 10 years. So I will begin with observations. So here are two observations. So the first one is observation in, of class zero envelope by Galamet et al., where they measure the beta index, which is the exponent of the variation of the dust opacity as a function of the frequency. So in the ASM, we have typically a large beta above 1.5. And what they report in a class zero envelope is lower beta. And they interpret this by the presence of large grain in this class zero envelope, which means that, well, dust might have grown very early on in this class zero sources. The second plot showed the disk radius measured with the CO emission, so the gas disk radius, and the dust disk radius in class 2 disk, so after 1 to 3 million years of evolution. And what Sanchis et al. Show is that, well, the disk radius measured in the gas is always systematically a factor of a few larger than the dust disk radius, which means that the dust has decoupled from the gas evolution very early on. So these two results indicate that, well, dust grain population should evolve. It should grow and drift very early on at the class zero stage. So a lot of work has been done in the past 5 years in order to include dust evolution in a numerical model. So here is the first example where the dynamical coupling of dust grain with the gas has been incorporated. So the dust grains are subject to a drag force from the gas, and this drag force is directly proportional to the size of the grain. So the larger the grain, the weaker the coupling with the gas. So one can characterize this coupling using this Stokes parameter, Stokes number, sorry, which is the ratio between the stopping time, so the time it needs for dust grain to adjust to velocity difference in the gas, with the dynamical time, which will be the orbital time in a disk or the free fall time in a collapsing core. So in Le Brillier et al., we follow the evolution of dust grain size distribution. So the size ranged from nanometer up to a few tenths of micrometers. What you see here is the evolution of the dust to gas ratio. So all what will be blue will be dust depleted, and red will be dust enriched. And you see the corresponding dust total density map. So you see that as collapse proceed, well, we have a variation in the dust-to-gas ratio very early on at the collapse stage, so early in the class zero phase. You see depletion here in the outflow cavity, and you see that the disk which is forming is dust-enriched. So if large grains are present at the collapse stage, then the disk will be initially dust-enriched. Other work have also tried to look at the evolution of the dust size distribution, including dust growth. So the first work is by here Guillet et al. Using 1D spherical model and accounting for turbulence and ambipolar diffusion as possible sources as for velocity drift between grains of different charge of different sizes. Okay, and what they show is that when turbulence and ambipolar diffusion are included in the model, basically grain can grow up to sizes of 10 microns, and the small grains are removed. So you see that from the initial MRN size distribution, we evolve very rapidly to a completely different size distribution. Okay. This has been further confirmed in the work by Matthew Bate last year, so I cannot finish the talk without mentioning the work from Matthew Bate. So here it is. So he has modeled the collapse of a one solar mass dense core, including also dust growth. So what he shows is that within the disk, the small grains are depleted, so have disappeared, and then as density increases, larger and larger grains can be formed up to sizes of about 40 microns. So there is a lot of work going on here, okay, in the community. So more to come in the coming years. And if the size distribution change, it will affect the MHD resistivities. You see here that playing with the maximum size or the minimum size of the dust grain for a given distribution, this changes the resistivities by orders of magnitude. Okay, which means that if dust grain evolve, we should then couple the dust evolution with the MHD evolution of the collapsing core. So here is an illustration, the work by Zhao et al. 2016, where they show that if small grains are removed, then larger disks can form. So you see here a clear difference between the two models if one accounts for dust growth. So to finish, I think that the next 10 years, first, we will have better constraints on the dust properties inside the class zero protostar, so in order to test whether dust can grow and also drift very early on. Clearly, the model should couple the dust evolution with the non-ideal MHD, as we have seen. A thing that I've not mentioned so far is protostellar feedback. So also protostellar feedback should be included. So first, it will radiate, so heat the gas, increase possibly the ionization, and also there is the possibility to accelerate cosmic ray deep inside the collapsing protostar. And finally, all the work I've presented so far consider isolated a core. Okay, so as we have seen, star might form in clusters. So we have to extend this work to non-isolated conditions to see the robustness of the picture I've drawn here. So I will let you with my conclusion. I won't describe them because I'm running out of time. But just I would like to mention the last one. I think the field now is slowly drifting toward a scenario where stars and planets are forming concurrently. So more to come in the next year. Thank you.
You can decide if our questions are ideal or non-ideal. Let's go over here.
Hello, Peter Voigtke from Austria. I would like to comment on the sizes of the dust and the CO. You said it's observed that the CO is larger and therefore we have drift. But even a well-mixed model without drift will give you that effect very naturally because the dust is optically thin, the CO is optically thick. So as you go outside, you lose the continuum signal, but the lines are keep on going. So it's a very, very natural effect. You don't necessarily need drift for that. However, when you take that into account, you can try to actually work out the effect that drift can add to this. But the major effect is optically thickness. I want to just ask you to whether you have taken that into account.
No, so what? So currently, dust dynamical evolution is only included for at the collapse stage, so very early on at the class zero stage, and there is no difference between the dust and the gas disk.
No, in model, but in the interpretation of the observations.
So it's my ignorance of observations. So okay. I interpreted that, so maybe it's a big shortcut from my side.
Let's talk about it.
Let's make progress on the line in the back right.
Yeah, John Tobin, NRAO. Very nice work, Benoit, and you and your co-authors. My question goes back to your distribution of dust disk sizes, which you were showing in the beginning. So, my question is, one of the things that's very interesting about that plot is the huge range of dust disk sizes you get at all stages of or all classes of star formation. And so, if you have non-ideal MHD supplying magnetic braking, what I would like to know is, and that sort of takes out the initial angular momentum of the infalling gas as setting the disk size. So do you have any ideas of what is it that gives us this huge spread of dust disk sizes even very early on?
Okay, so indeed, so the spread is one order of magnitude, a bit more. More than one order. Okay, so I think, if non-ideal effect regulates the disk formation and early evolution, so in a work by Enbel et al., they show that the disk size will evolve with time, okay, if the mass of the system of the star and the disk increases. Okay, so you might have a time evolution where the disk is growing in time. So I don't know what are the age of these class zero sources also. So I think that simulation report quite consists, there is an agreement that the disk grow with size. So what I've reported here is the very early stages, so a few thousand years after the formation of the protostar, and probably these sources are much older. Okay. I should say that, however, so playing with initial condition, so initial turbulence, for low mass core, so initial turbulence, initial degree of rotation, this not, does not change a lot the initial disk radius. Okay.
All right, thank you.
In the back, and then here in front.
Hi, this is a comment. Thank you a lot for this very nice review. It would be very useful, actually. But since you mentioned the first evidence for an image to this wind, I think but because of the timing of how this is prepared, you may have missed paper about the first direct observations that trace the magnetic field lines in the launching region of a jet. And the corresponding modeling that I was part of. So in that case, I will just invite you to please go and check out my poster.
Okay. Thanks for that. Well, I should say that this is the review of the work before 2020.
Yes, exactly.
So we tried to include the recent work. But
yeah, absolutely. No
problem. Del Plunkett from NRAO. I noticed in the simulation that was playing while you were talking about non-ideal MHD. I don't know if it was Masson 2016 or Tsukamoto 2015. Mm-hmm. Whatever the color scale was seems to be kind of flashing in brightness. Is that evidence, or can you just maybe explain a little bit more what's the color scale there? And second, that made me realize I didn't hear much about variability in this process. Can you just comment on if that even exists at this time?
I'm sorry for that. So I think it's my laziness here because I did not fix the maximum and minimum value in the color map. So the flashing is due to that. Okay. And the time scale here is, as you see, about 30,000 years. So a few thousand years after the formation of the first Larson core at that scale. Okay. So there is not a huge variability here. The disk you see is relatively constant in size. So you see that first, well, the disk is born small and then grow in size.
Thank you.
Okay, again, we have a lot of people, so if people could keep their questions short and short answers, we can get through more of you.
Okay, I'm Yu Gasso from the Korean Astronomy and Space Science Institute. And I have a question about the relation between the disk size and the magnetic field strength. So is there any observational evidence or constraint about the relation between strength and the disk size?
To my knowledge, no. I've shown only two measurements of magnetic field in disks. So I think maybe more to come, hopefully, in the next years.
Thank you.
Yeah. In the back.
I am Yoko Oya from Kyoto University. I'm interested in the angular momentum during the disk formation and the outflow launching. I think the effect of the magnetic field depends on how strong the magnetic field is and the strong how strong the coupling is. So let me think about the two cases. One is one with a strong magnetic field and another one with a strong coupling. What is the difference between their evolution? Do you expect how do you expect?
I think the most important is strong coupling first. And then as soon as there is a little of magnetic field, so I would say mass to flux ratio or critical mass to flux ratio less than 10, the magnetic field is amplified in the envelope because it is coupled. So the magnetic field gets strong in the center part. So magnetic breaking is efficient.
Thank you.
Here in the front.
Tristan Guillot from Observatoire de la Côte d'Azur here. This can potentially change completely how we view the early evolution of protoplanetary disks. Will mostly expand and can be very hot for the solar system. I mean, that can change the chemistry quite a bit. So I was wondering whether you have an idea of the temperatures that you would get in the inner 10 AU or 5 AU.
Like that, no. Also, there is a question of the timing of the disk. So some simulation that show a disk is forming around the second core. before the disk around the first core. Some show that the disk around the first core forms before the disk around the second core. So I think that the model should clarify the timing of the formation of the disk in the coming years. Yeah.
Okay, back left, then back middle.
Yeah, Daniel Seifert, University Cologne. Nice talk. Short question, you mentioned it in your outlook that the feedback from protostars is not completely included yet, like cosmic rays or X-rays, and they could boost up the ionization degree. So how sure are you that the non-ideal effects are so important if you would include this?
That's a big question. We have to test it. Yeah. I should say that, well, we need a central source in order for the protostellar feedback to operate, okay? So the initial stage should be safe.
Yijin Zhang from University of Virginia. So you showed the comparison of the cell flow morphologies between the simulation and observations. They look very similar. So my question is, does the envelope or the distribution of the ambient material play any role in this, or it's completely due to the morphology of magnetic fields, for example?
I must admit, I don't know. So maybe you should refer to Masahiro Mashida, who is in the audience today.
Okay, front and then back, and I'm not sure we'll get much further.
Hi, Wenrei Xu from Flatiron Institute. Really nice talk. I saw you mentioned that non-ideal MGD is helping to avoid the magnetic braking catastrophe. And in fact, in some of the simulations, including some of your work, some of my simulations, we seem to be seeing that ambient power diffusion is too efficient. Your basically magnetic field becomes unimportant at all inside the disk, and the disk becomes self-regulated by gravitational instability instead. And that interpretation seems to allow us to make, say, some interesting reinterpretations of the observation. So I just want to ask you about, like, what's your take on this? What are the simulation evidences? Say, do you think we do see this trend that disks, at least in simulations, are commonly gravitationally unstable now?
I didn't want to show this slide, but I will. Here is a work by Patrick and Bell, 2020. So, accounting for ambipolar diffusion. What he shows is that if we put a sink particle, so a sink particle represents a point mass particle where we don't want to resolve the dynamics below a certain scale, okay? And playing with the sink particle properties, then we end up with a disk mass, which are quite different. So they can vary of orders of magnitude, depending on the accretion, so the scheme that is used. So it acts like an inner boundary, the sink particle. But the disk size does not vary so much as the mass. So maybe this gravitational instable disks are just due to the fact that we have a limited resolution.
Okay, in the back, then maybe we can work in here.
I'm Anna McLeod, Durham University. Thank you, Benoit. That was a great talk. So presumably, and maybe I missed it, most of what you talked about is based on solar-type environments. So I was wondering if you could comment on magnetic braking and disk sizes in low metallicity and low dust content environments, especially when it comes to massive stars?
I'm sorry, I cannot. I hope there are some posters here. Please show up.
Okay, at least it was a short answer.
Short answer, I know that, for instance, in the POP3 star, so first star community, there are evidence that non-ideal MHT can also be at play, even without dust grains. But I cannot say what are the exact conclusions on this effect.
Thank you. Okay, but let's go here, and that may be the end.
Okay, yes. Nagayoshi Ohashi from AJ. So I'm curious about your radial distribution of J, angular momentum, specific angular momentum, and you made a specific statement that even less than 1,000 AU, you might see the specific angular momentum decreasing as a function of radius. Mm-hmm. So we have been, of course, spending a lot of time to measure that kind of distribution, and we know that it's gonna be very difficult to measure power, accurately. And so we have been saying that angular momentum is more or less constant within that kind of scale. So I'm just wondering whether you could really tell whether that decrease is observationally found.
Okay. So for this, so clearly this trend, I think, is observed by everybody.
That part is fine within okay. Southern EU.
Okay, this part, but I think it depends on the object. Huh? You see, so a given color shows a single object. So I don't know how they derived this, so I'm sorry. So, but I think you see for objects, indeed, it's more or less constant, but for some other, it is decreasing. So here, you should talk to Anaëlle. So I think she will be happy to receive emails okay. after this talk.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, we are formally out of time or over time, so I think we should continue the discussion. We have an extended afternoon poster session, so perhaps we can continue this conversation there. Yeah. Let's thank our speaker again, please.
Thank you.
And your day is not done. We have posters between...